part of our meeting. I would like to congratulate everybody with our first real snow and first real beginning of the winter today, especially our guests from our countries. I mean the countries that our guests that come here especially for experience real Russian winter. So we have first the introduction of our very important roles for the meeting. And the first role who will help us with the grammar and the word of the day. Natively he is from Italian, but he speaks also German and English. So I would like to welcome here Martin, who will be the grammar master and grammarian and word master of the day.
I'm from Italy, from the north of Italy, so my native language is German. I'm here now for 1 year. I make an exchange program in the Bauman University. And the word of today is profound. It means very great or very intense. Some synonyms from it are, for example, great, very great, deep, or overwhelming.
So I would like to introduce our AHA counter, Georgi. Okay. So please.
My name is Georgi and I'm here as an AHA counter. So my duty is to count all mistakes who people make in words. Not mistakes actually. Making sounds, which is not very appropriate. So that's it.
The next very important role, especially for this meeting, because we have a full pack of 4 speeches, so we all have to be really in our time limits. It's our timer today, Karina.
Good evening, dear Toastbusters and guests. As timer, I am responsible today for monitoring time for each part of our meeting and for each person. I have 3 color signals, which you will see during your speech. You will see green light when you are on the right place with the minimum recommended time for your speech, and you will see yellow light when you have reached almost the end of your speech, when you have 30 seconds until the end. And you will see the red light when it's recommended time to accomplish your speech. And for the timing, we have from 5 to 7 minutes for all our prepared speakers. And we have special rules for today for our table topic speakers. 30 seconds, from 30 seconds until 1 minute. And we have from 2 up to 3 minutes for our personal evaluator. And 4 minutes for the grammarian report. And our counter will have 2 minutes for his report at the end. So let's be on time.
Okay, so now we can start our speech session, and I think the theme of our today's meeting will be masters, because each speech today will have more or less big or small master in it, and after each speech we will have 1 minute to fill our evaluation forms. Please tell me now if you don't have one. Okay, and the first speech of Vladimir Danilenko will be project number two, and the name is of this project is Evaluation and Feedback. So he will tell us the second speech, and he should the purpose of the speech for the member is to demonstrate that he applied the feedback received after the first part of the speech. And the title of the speech is The Secret of Life. Let's imagine we are in a pub. Actually, let's imagine we are in the pub in the UK in the 1950s, and we are having a dinner, for example, fish and chips and stuff. Cheers. So we are having a dinner, and for some weird reason, two men interrupt the whole proceeding with an announcement. We have discovered the secret of life. Sounds pretty bold, right? I would not believe it in a general case. However, if we are in the 1950s and we are in the pub named Eagle, and these two men are actually, their names are Watson and Crick, their statement is entirely correct. Back in 1953, these two guys come up with a proper understanding how DNA molecule looks like, double helix or spiral, and how the genetic hereditary mechanisms work on the molecular level. Fast forward 60 years, and now we have widely available, pretty affordable genetic testing. And you won't believe how affordable they are right now. Just yesterday, when I was preparing for the second half of my speech, in Amazon I discovered that there are now genetic testing available for dogs and cats. This is completely insane from my point of view. Back 7 years ago, when I decided to give it a shot and to try it on myself, this was not the case. So, okay, I decided to take the analysis, and how it looks like. The company, the service provider, 23andMe in my case, the one which is based in the US, provide you with a plastic container, which you are supposed to fill with your saliva. So in your saliva, there are a number of skin cells from the interior surface of your cheeks. And these skin cells are processed in the facility. The genes within the cells are being analyzed, and you provided with the results. So, very briefly, I will describe some of my results. The first group of results, there will be four of them, is called genetic health risks. To cut the story short, actually, I will just say I do not have any major or any significant health risks associated with the tests they run on my DNA, and the second will be a little bit more interesting. The second group is called traits. The traits are generally neutral features within one's body, appearance or organism. So actually I started my speech today with drinking alcohol, not just for fun. This was an experiment. In the results I received from the company, the results say that I do not flush when I drink alcohol.
It means that my face doesn't turn red. And as you can see, this is true. So this was the correct prediction. Another prediction is about finger length. You might want to look at your palm right now. You will notice that either your index finger or your ring finger is shorter or longer. It depends on the people. So the prediction of the company 23andMe, in my case, were again right. My index finger is slightly shorter than the ring finger. This is again defined by genes. However, not all of the findings, there were actually pretty much, pretty many of them, not all of these findings were correct. So for example, I was predicted to have issues when I consume milk products. I do not have such issues, I can drink milk a lot. This actually shows that, at least in the majority of cases, the predictions based on genes are not guaranteed. They show only the predisposition for certain conditions or illnesses. They are not carved in stone. The third group of findings is about ancestry. Again, to make the story shorter, I will tell about the most interesting finding. And actually, it arrived a couple of years after I did my tests, so they keep adding some new information. Turned out that I have a pretty substantial amount of Neanderthal genes in my DNA. So strictly speaking, I'm not even 100% human. But do not laugh, because all of you are pretty much the same. Only the small number of populations in the central region of Africa can name themselves as purely Homo sapiens. The fourth and the last chapter in my talk is about DNA relative search. The database of DNA of 23andMe customers have 3 million people in it right now. And out of these 3 million people, they were able to find 122 of my so-called fourth cousins. This means that I share with these people great, great, great grandparent. So our lineages split 150 years ago, something like this. Depends on the age when the child is conceived. And again, an interesting finding. Turned out that the person to whom I am the closest in this DNA relative search is pretty well-known Russian politician. However, I will not tell the names. I will not tell his name right now because I am a little bit embarrassed. So I should probably finish my presentation. And in conclusion, I will just briefly say that all these findings definitely boosted my interest in early human history, in genetics, and in biology. And this information really puts you in a very rich and extra context for your own life. Things like country borders, nationalities, races, and even, as you can see, the boundaries of biological species begin to blur when you look back in time. And all this information is actually encoded within your own genes and the cells of your own body. So I would suggest to go explore it for yourself. However, the last thing. You might want to postpone this act because on my next projects, I plan to tell about the downsides of this move.
Of the DNA tests. So,
well, it is a tricky question and I would like to address it in my next speech. However, just to tell, it is something about $100 in the US. In Russia, it is more expensive.
Okay, thank you. So it's okay to make it for my cat or dog? Okay, so the first mastery of the day is revealed. So the speech about the color, actually the speech about the nature of life, about the DNA. So,
second speech will be project number 3, research and presenting. And the purpose of this project for the member is to learn or review actually the basic research methods. So I would like to welcome here Ivan Shlyaev, and the speech title is The Color of Light.
Presentation, and you won't believe what I'll tell you today. Yeah, so I have a bag. I have an object that brings you a lot of trouble and a lot of frustration, but only when you realize that it's not in near your hand, that you don't have. You don't. So the line is too early switched off. Can we bring up the line again? Yeah, wait a second. I'll tell you when to turn it off. So this is the object of today's speech. Can you tell me what is the color of this object?
We suppose white.
White, right.
We suppose.
You suppose that it's white. The light, please. But what you'll say right now, what's the color?
Orange.
White. Yellow.
It's all about orange, yellow, right? Can you please turn the light on? Yeah, so it appears that the color, it's not the property of the object itself, but it's somehow linked to the light outside, yes, or the environment. And throughout the history, the two major parties who studied the light were the scientists and the artists, right? That's obvious. So, till the 18th century, the Western world fine art looked something like that. No, solid colors. So if you speak about the tree, it was green. If you speak about the drapery, it was red, and so on. So it was pretty straightforward. In the science world, it was even weirder, because scientists were absolutely sure that in order to perceive an object, our eyes were radiating some kind of rays. These rays were reflected out of the object, and then our eyes again catched it. But when this guy showed up, Mr. Thomas Young, he actually scientifically proved that the light is a wave. And this changed absolutely everything, because if light is a wave, it gets reflected. And even me standing here, I'm somehow reflecting all the light that is reflected by you, and you reflected by the light which is reflected by other person. So the entire environment is somehow flashed and then washed in the light. So he proved that the light is the wave. And he explained why we see color. So, when an object, you see that it is white, because the light is get reflected by the object, and the object absorbs a portion of light, and the other one, it is reflected and it's catched by other eyes. So if you see that the leaf is green, just because it absorbed all the colors, but besides the green one. So this idea, this philosophy, inspired an entire generation of artists, the impressionists. These weird-looking guys with big beards, yeah, they look hilarious. But the philosophy was absolutely different one, because they started to do things different than their ancestors. Previously, all the artists had, you know, small pots with color, green color for leaves, blue color for the sky, and so on. But these people, they did it a different way. They left the dark workshops and they moved to the nature in order to study the nature, how it works, why the light is in that, what is the color of the sunset, and they even actually go to the seaside to see the sunset. They all are pretty different. We see Renoir. The philosophy is always the same. He is showing the human, the personality, but the colors, the philosophy is the same. We see Degas, also the same idea, but they are different. Let's take, for example, Claude Monet. He is considered one of the major figures in this movement, and actually his impact was great. And actually he had two sons, and there's a funny story, because he was always taking his son with him while he was painting, and he was giving to his son several canvases, he was sitting down painting, and while the sun was moving, the light was changing, the environment of course as well, the kids were switching the canvases. That's what we have. The same topic treated in different light. Again, the same topic treated in different light. Every single piece of work is different. And an interesting thing happened when the science started to progress. Albert Einstein showed up, and together with several scientists, they proved that besides being wave, light is also a stream of particles. No, that's a miracle. Stream of particle, wave, something unrelated, but the light is two things at the same time. And the art was also progressing, so physics impacted the art, because this person showed up and he invented a way of mixing colors. Instead of taking two different colors, actually mixing them and obtaining the third color, he discovered that you can do it another way. You can take two different colors, put them together, and the mixing will occur in the human's eyes, in the observer's eyes. So this is called optical mixing. And that's what we have. Pointillism, this is a branch of the Impressionism. The great paintings were created in this style and this technique. What I want to say today, I'm sure that we have a lot of professionals in different fields today. And for sure you have not only your job, but also some things that are interesting for you. And I really want to encourage you to find things that are on the intersection of these two fields, major. And who knows, if you'll find something interesting, maybe more light will be in our world. Thank you very much.
To make things even more complicated, I will add that the color actually has the temperature. And the more higher the temperature is, more bluish the light is. So I'm very sorry about I'm not let you let you have 1 minute to evaluate the previous speech. So now I will give you 1 minute and a little bit more to evaluate Ivan and the first speech. The next project, number 4, will be about understanding of leadership style. The title of this project will be Why I'm Not Your Messiah, and Ivan Cernovetic will tell us about his next
project. The beautiful thing about my speech today is that for me it's a free sales pitch for what I actually do during the day. So that is great. I titled my speech Why I Am Not Your Messiah, because it's about language learning. And a lot of people, when they start learning a language, they see their tutor, coach, teacher, call them what you want, as their messiah. Yeah? I see that with my students pretty much every time, yeah? Every new student. It's always the same problem. Yeah? People always fail for the same reasons. And today I'm going to run you through, well, for brevity's sake, I cut it down to 3 reasons. Yeah, actually there's more, but they kind of go together. And I'm going to run you through the 3 main reasons why people fail, what their problems are, and how, like, what solution I provide, but then again, what solution I do not provide. Yeah? So people actually know why I am not their messiah and why I'm not their silver bullet and the person who can save their language learning. And the first and most important thing really here is when you start learning a language, you have to know the why. So why are you actually learning a language? Yeah? Why is that so important? Because many people have problems with discipline, time management, staying consistent, pretty much learning every day. And I always hear the same excuses. Oh, I don't have time. Yeah? Oh, like I start, but then I quit. Yeah? I get distracted. Yeah? All of these things, usually those are listed as several problems, but they actually all tie into the same thing, which is you do not know why you actually want to learn the language. Yeah? You have no vision. And I can actually give you a very vivid example from my own students here. I have two students, like I have a lot, but these two are very good examples. Yeah, one, it's a woman, she studies, she knows no German, I teach German and English, she knows no German, comes in every 2 weeks for 1.5 hours, yeah? What do you think her results are? Non-existent, of course not, yeah? Because she has no, she tells me, I don't have time, this and that, yeah, but that's all BS, yeah, we know that's not true. She doesn't have a real vision. I have another student, who, and by the way, this woman is actually not really good with language learning, but neither is the second. The second is also not really talented, yeah? But she has a very clear vision. She wants to study in Germany in a couple of months, and she wants to know the language well enough. And she studies really like she works like a horse. And this is why she sees results. And so here I come in, yeah? Can I provide the solution here? No, I cannot tell you why you should learn the language. This is one of my first questions when I get a new student, why do you actually learn the language? And if the student tells me like, because I'm interested, it's not good, yeah? Like, I can provide you the, how can I say, I can lead by example, I can tell you from my own experience, because I speak several languages, and I learned them pretty well, I can tell you, okay, this is what you can expect, this is the results you can expect. This is what it's going to be like, yeah? I'm not going to sugarcoat it, it's going to be hard, but I can help you with that. But why? You have to know yourself. And the second problem ties actually very much into that. It's goal setting. It's similar, but it's not quite the same, yeah? Goal setting is what you want to achieve, the why is why you want to achieve it, yeah? So for example, the second student I just talked about, yeah, she wants to study in Germany, so she has a clear goal, she knows the date when she's moving, she has a clear goal and she works towards that deadline. We all know from school times or university or work, yeah, deadlines work very well with humans, and humans who don't have deadlines, they work not very well. Yeah? Again, I can provide another example here. When I study Spanish, which I still do, I put myself an exam, which in the end I didn't take because I made a stupid mistake, but I put myself an exam, I didn't have to do it, yeah? I studied Spanish purely for myself, but still, I worked towards that exam, and by the end, I clearly exceeded that goal, so I would have passed the exam, but that's for another day, this story, yeah? So you have to have a clear goal, a clear deadline. It can be a date of moving, or it can be an exam, or, well, these two are probably the best ones, yeah? Like, it has to be something very strict, yeah? Something which you cannot move, yeah? Not like, when I hear a student tell me, so I ask him, why do you want to learn? And they tell me, well, because I'm interested. And I already get like, okay, and what is your goal? Well, I do not have one. Then I already know the student is not going to stay on for long. The third problem is that people tell me, okay, I do not know how to learn it, and I need someone to practice with. Okay, now we're talking, and this is an actual legitimate problem, and this is actually where I really come in, yeah? I can help you with that, because again, I know my stuff, I studied several languages, I am there to correct your mistakes, I tell you exactly what you should do, why you should do it, and I have the credentials to back it up, yeah? So imagine language learning, for example, like climbing a mountain, yeah? You are the person who wants to climb the mountain, and I'm the Sherpa, or whatever you pronounce it in English. I can tell you, I've been up the mountain quite a few times, yeah? You just tell me, okay, I want to climb up this mountain. I tell you, okay, I know how to do it. I know exactly what you need. This is how long it's going to take. But it's not going to be easy. I cannot carry your stuff, yeah? I can carry some of the weight, but not everything, yeah? So you need to make, you know, the steps yourself, and you need to do the work yourself. So, if that hasn't scared you off too much, my sort of in-your-face language learning or language coaching style, then please by all means approach me, like for German and English. I still have spots open, so as I said, for me it's a free sales pitch, and that's it.
So, I think that Jun just told us about one very, very important thing, but ultimately, at least I think so, we are the ultimate reason that happens to us. So, again, you have 1 minute to relate the speech. And this will be a speech about the project number 6 in introduction to a Toastmasters mentoring. And this speech will be, the purpose of the speech, remember, is to share some aspects of the previous experience as a protege. And I would like to welcome here our very dear senior. Your applause. Very huge applause for Margarita one more time. And so, and the topic of the speech will be my mentor. So please.
Good evening, dear Toastmasters and most welcome guests. Then presenting my second part of the story of my mentee experience. So the first part was like about general concepts, and today's second part will be about more personal things, and it will be really entertainment for you guys. And firstly, I wanna start with a small piece of video that we shoot this summer with Masha. Сбросить вес. В принципе, позаниматься спортом было бы неплохо. Я бы хотела прийти в некую хорошую форму. Это не те цели, которые способны вас мотивировать. Although this speech was about running, in the context of running, we should admit that a lot of people nowadays can't motivate themselves and they set wrong goals. Sometimes it also happens with me. And now I want to ask you to ask yourself what motivates you the most, what gives you the strong motivation to do things. In my case, it's my mentor who motivates me, who inspires me to do lots of great things and to develop and so on and so forth. It all happened this summer when I stumbled on a comment where someone, I don't know really who, called Masha, someone who called Masha, asked for help to make a video. And you know, making video is my pleasure. And I was like, yeah, I should try it. I should connect with her and maybe make a video. Who knows what will go from it. And you know, yeah, who made it? Yeah, and this was the day that I met Masha, that I was really inspired, really motivated, and you know, the next day I ran 10 kilometers run just being motivated, just getting these advices, just working with them. And the other days I made a video, we liked it and decided, yeah, we should continue doing this. And then we visited Kaluga and make a video, we visited Yaroslavl, Rostov, Kostroma and make a video. And also we made it to VDNH on the very early morning on bikes and also make a video. And now we have 9 unique videos throughout our mentor-mentee experience, I don't know. they are unique, they are really different. And you can see them on Masha's Instagram, that's here, that's where we download them. But you know, I think that none of you have seen really one video from our playlist. So maybe now I should...
Yes, today we are with you. Парк Лилии.
Парк растут липы, березы, вязы, ели и каштаны.
С вами была рубрика Николай Безлов.
Мария Калинкина.
Слагали гатичи, достигали Пулцевское городище.
Мышка!
Полный заучил на направо и направляемся в сторону набережной. Мы не решили снять лестницу. Мы снимаем лестницу, идем по лестнице на набережную. Ну вот мы и выходим на набережную. Большой, большой.
But you know, we have all these videos. We some kind of get used to it. Small format, just sharing experience with the audience. And now, 1 week ago, Masha had new idea. Rita, we should make new kind of videos. We should make the interviews. And yeah, that's what we do. Last Friday, we shot interview videos. It was a great challenge for me because instead of one small camera, I have to deal with four of them, three microphones, two tripods. You have to be concentrated. You have to see the situation and literally be awake. And yeah, we made it. And I want to show you a small intro from it.
Друзья, мы подготовили для вас серию интервью про замечательных людей мира сего, знакомых нам с вами реальных и земных, людей, которые уже предприняли и остаются на коне, людей, которые готовы поделиться и рассказать свою историю о том, как это было. Мы снимаем про них биографично.
So yeah, that's the intro of our new project. And now we have, that will be our first episode. Masha was talking with her mother, the great lawyer, Мария Юрьевна Каринкина. And you know, I suggest you to subscribe to our channel, not to miss it. Because I should say to you that we have a choir of other people who want to shoot the video with us. And in conclusion, I should say that these video examples, that's just my story, my think of mentor-mentee connection, how we did it, and how we continue doing it. And having a mentor is such a thing that I think everyone should have a mentor. And dear Masha, I'm so grateful for you that you are my mentor. And I think that it's just only the beginning of something really great and really profound. Thank you.
Well, this speech was about the Mishka. And the most unexpected moment was about. So please subscribe to our channel, hit this red button. Okay, so one more time, we have one of the way to speech. Break. We are going to our part of table topic session. And I would like to welcome here where our table topic master, Alexey.
First, I want to ask you a question. I don't want to intimidate you with this question, but who of you came here from office? Who of you came from office? You from office? No? Margarita, you're not from office? You're not working? Good.
No.
So, oh, you came from office. Okay, very good. So, when we are in office and we have to make a presentation, we want to be profound and, you know, very, very professional, eh? But who of you been on a smoking area or drinking a coffee? All of you. Yes? We drink coffee, of course, we're not working. So, what we do when we are drinking a coffee, we socialize with each other. Do we get prepared for that? Usually not. Table topics. It's an exercise for the speaking unprepared. So, today, we're going to do completely different things. I'm going to invite three of you for each session and give you 30 seconds to talk. Okay, I'm not going to tell you the rest of the details, otherwise someone will be interested. Who of you are willing to be in the first three? Your man? Yes, yes, you're welcome. Come in. You're going to stay like this? Great. The topic of table topic session is no topic.
Okay.
Your man. You are friends, you meet. You start. You speak for 30 seconds. You continue the conversation on the same idea, in the same discussion for next 30 seconds. And you finish up with the rest of the 30 seconds. Your man, go ahead.
Guys, how tall you are today? I feel so small near you. What do you think about
this? Actually, no, I am a fan
of... No, I'm apologizing. Your man, you're not supposed to talk to them. You're supposed to talk about some topic come up in your mind. You're not socializing with them. Then you're picking up what he was talking about,
okay.
Whatever it is. And you continue and then you pick it up. You're not talking to each other.
Yeah. The pictures of Monet were very impressive. I visited some museum and I was impressed by this, you know, these colors, these impressions, and I feel so overwhelmed and I want to research this topic.
I remember quite well my trip to Paris. Frankly speaking, I'm a great fan of Impressionism. That's why I was really eager to visit one of the main museums of Impressionism in Paris, which is situated right close to Louvre. And when I entered the Orangery, it's called like that, I was so fascinated that I really got like stuck. And it was impossible to think about something else but these wonderful flowers of Monet.
Okay, I don't know why we started speaking about art at Paris. I think actually what had the most profound, how can I say, impact on me in Paris was actually how bad the metro smells. Have you actually ever used the Paris subway? It smells like pee. And there are also a lot of really bad people, Donald Trump would call them, on there, and it's really unsafe. I do not like Paris at all. I think the Orangerie is terrible. I think the Louvre is completely overrated. The, what do you call it? In German it's Mona Lisa, like the, you know, the famous painting with the woman who actually doesn't smile, also complete, don't like it at all, it's really small. So actually don't go to Paris. If you want to go somewhere, go to Kaluga, because we saw in Kaluga you can have a great time.
Great. Okay, guys, three of you, and we will make it a little bit more complicated. Who else gonna be? Irina? Oh, you just let them come.
Yes.
Who's gonna be next three? I mean, in this way, we're gonna cover all of you. That's what is exciting, really, so we have everyone. Yes. Yes, very good.
I feel like I have to participate.
Yes.
And
one
to
more person? One more person? Yes, Orson, please come. Okay, you have to speak for 30 seconds steadily, without stopping, until you see the green light, okay? Second rule, find the topic which is very complicated for the next person to talk about. So you will try to challenge the next person speaking with some difficult topic. It's actually the first person starts.
Okay, let's go. So actually, I started my entire presentation about how physics impacted the art, because I read the book and the book was telling about what is in common between physics and the spiritual teachings of, for example, Indian culture or other things. And essentially, it occurs that modern physics is saying the same things as the ancient teachings. About the fact that the universe is everything in the universe is in motion, matter is indivisible. About the fact that the entire universe is a general one; it cannot be divided in, you know, in different parts. Thank you.
Okay. So, would you like to change me to the physics theme, right? Okay, I will continue about the physics. Actually, the talks about the physics is not changing for me at all because I'm a physicist. No price. Okay, and
what I learned about the physics from my university course. What I have to say that I learned that philosophy is more actually exciting than the physics. So if you have children, please encourage them first to go to consider to go to philosophy department, not to the physics department, and to challenge you, I'd like maybe you to continue the philosophy talk.
Philosophy talk about physics, things. I can remember a story with my father. He is a very simple man, and when I said to him, "Do you know, father, light is wave. It is not
particles.
It is not particles. It is a wave." My father, how can you can think that, my son? It is not wave. It is not. It is not wave. You can see in the river wave is sound, but it is not wave. And I can't believe that my father he allowed to himself not to believe in our science,
Very good. Was it difficult?
It's very
interesting. Was it difficult?
Not really.
Oh, really?
We're just bad.
We're going to level 3 right now.
Who's going
to
be next?
It's going to be very challenging the next one. 3 person. Please, Fred. Come on, guys. We don't have a lot of time. Okay.
Come on.
One more? Yes? Okay. Here we have 4, including myself, and I will start speaking, so you have to continue my talk. I said it's more advanced level. Try to stay within the topic and try to develop and talk steadily for 30 seconds. I'm not going to talk for 30 seconds, I just give an idea. You know, some time ago we had a tragedy. The one with the largest submarine, atomic submarine, Kursk, had been lost, and a lot of people have been lost for us, as a society. And when they've been under the water in a big depths, the company, whole company called Mammoet was called with a special cranes and equipment to rescue the submarine. So they brought a lot of barges and cranes and been working on the rescue.
Right. I think it is really brave people who are decided to go to be a soldiers at Navy, right? Navy soldiers are really brave because they decided to go to this box, metal box, and they just think they decide to agree with everything that they are going to be sink at the really bottom. It's really, really strange for normal person, because I personally afraid to go down deep in water. But when I think about submarines, it's really, really unbelievable for me. I think those people are really brave. So that's my thought about those stories. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I also think they are brave, but at the same time they have prepared very well, mm-hmm. to every condition what can happen, and to a submarine, not much can happen, I think, except if there's an enemy. And yes, there are.
In my childhood, I read a French author, it's Jules Verne. It's called 20,000 Leagues Under Water, about Captain Nemo, which go deep in submarine. And when I read this book, my dream was to become the same person. I thought he's very brave and a challenge with some big problems maybe. But after when I grew up, I changed my mind because I thought when you go to this submarine, you're not on the Earth for a long time. So it's like the space. When the people go into space, it's the same time for a long time. So when you came back to on Earth, you can lost a lot of relatives. That's what I thought. That's it.
I don't have a YouTube channel.
What do you have to do?
Okay, just again, we speak for 30 seconds. Speak on the topic that I will start. You need to continue and develop. You will see the green and we have 30 seconds, yellow 45 seconds, 1 minute red. So it's not supposed to be very long. When I worked on a drilling rig a long time ago, we're supposed to drill to get the oil from the ground. And I've been working for the one Turkish company, and before we start drilling, we always bring some gods or ships and cut them to have some blood to sacrifice the next wells. So I've always been seeking the cutting, the animals to sacrifice. Is it workable or not? How does it work?
Well, the good thing is that the world is moving away from oil and gas. Thus, we don't need to sacrifice sheep anymore as we move into renewable energy. Having solar energy, wind energy, batteries to store the energy. I don't think we need to sacrifice those poor sheep, but we can have a better future and have goats and energy at the same time.
I can see anything about oil and gas, but I can tell you about my experience in Turkey. Turkish people are very different. They have different traditions, different from us. And I was in my business trips in Turkey alone, and I was very surprised that every evening two people from my company who invited me guide me to the restaurant because I can eat alone. I am a self-made woman. It is not so difficult to find the restaurant. So I goes alone on the restaurant without them because they disturbed me. After 2 days of being together 20 hours a day, and after that, when I came to Russia, I surprisingly heard that my behavior was really very shocked for the local people because for women it's not allowed to be in restaurant alone. That's all about Turkey.
Dear fellow Toastmasters, yes, it was 5 seconds. Sometimes it's pretty difficult to support our meetings without any cognac. It was 10 seconds. So to support my colleagues about Turkish team and drilling team, I want to say in fact from Vladimir's speech that sometimes you can use ships and goats wool to touch it a lot, and it will be also electricity without any dinner. And yeah, that was advice. That's story. Thank you.
Thank you. Even more. I remember I used to read a book about energy, and that was something that the matter and the waves is something very similar, and only the absolute number is the speed of light, 200,000 kilometers per second. And that was an idea. If we take a photon, the one of the elements of the light, and we sit on top of the photon, you can imagine we're sitting on top of the photon, and we take a flashlight, and we switch on the flashlight. Doesn't it mean that we have a 300,000 kilometers plus 300,000 kilometers? But the theory said no, there is no larger speed. So even by sitting on the photon, you will not see the light in front of you because you're already in the maximum. So what do you think about it?
Well, actually, the thing is, I also have education in physics, so I tend to think in pretty analytical way here. It's not the theory says that you can't advance more than 300,000 meters per second. It's rather the formula leading to this conclusion. So basically, you can just fill in the numbers and variables within this formula, and you see that you are not able to get any more than this number. So.
I'm afraid that I don't have education in physics, that's why I'm a little bit confused to continue on the topic. However, I had physics classes in my institute. Actually, I graduated from this institute for Moscow Steel and Alice, and I'm really excited to be here after like many years. I would not say the exact number of years. And I was surprised how things are different here in comparison with what I remember from my past. And obviously, I don't remember anything from those physics lessons. That's why I mean, probably I should have started a little bit more better in a better way than I did in the past.
I didn't understand the main idea because I graduated law faculty, civil law, so I didn't know a lot about energy. I studied energy a little bit when I passed philosophy exam. My father maybe could explain you all laws of physics, but I can explain you just one idea that we all have two main resources, energy and time. And it's very important to save your energy, to have energy. So today is it's difficult to keep your energy, so I recommend you to be live in a good work-life balance, to sleep a lot, to something like that, and you will be happy.
Thank you very much.
I would like to welcome here General Loreto, Nikolai Denisenko.
So, within Toastmasters, we have three main pillars for education. One is prepared speeches. Second one is unprompted speeches, as we just had an exercise on. And the third one is evaluation. Because by getting a proper feedback,
we can learn faster, we can learn more effectively, and that's why it's so important. Without delay, I would like to invite to the stage Irina Suvorova, evaluator of personal evaluator of Ivan.
Good evening, dear Toastmasters, guests, and Ivan. Firstly, I like very much the title of your speech. Why I'm not your messiah? It is intrigue, and I immediately wanted to know the answer on this question. And very actual subject of the speech for us, Toastmasters, how to learn languages and typical mistakes during learning languages. Also, I was very, very impressed by your body language. What were you doing with your hands? It was different. It was very, very impressive, amazing, and vivid. Everyone, I think everyone in this audience, yes, has seen that Ivan really experienced speaker already. And your voice, oh my God, your voice. It was a different vocal variety and even actor playing in some moments when you told us about your lazy students. So, to my recommendations. The purpose of your project was to define your own leadership style and pass a test on the pathways and share the best with your results and your leader experience. And that was I didn't hear in your speech. I have known during the break only that your style is authoritative, but the audience hasn't known it until this moment. So my recommendation is connect more clear your test results with your own unique experience as a mentor and as a teacher. Also, the second one recommendation, it was a little bit difficult to follow your structure. Because usually we expect to hear one, two, three, in your case, three typical mistakes in the language learning. And I have remembered only one, to see the goal why you learn languages. But I asked Christina, maybe she remembers. Mm-hmm. And she remembers only two goals, mistakes, to see the goal and time management, to follow time management. Why we haven't remembered? Because of difficult structure. Please take it into attention. And you repeat it very often that I study many languages. I study many languages. I know what to tell you about languages. We know that you are experienced, Ivan. We have already understood it. And about your conclusion, you just said, that's it. That's it. I expect to see at least your smile. And as a maximum, maybe better, several advices how to define your goal and be more self-motivated, more time, more effective in time management for learning languages. So my conclusion is, was a very actual and very interesting speech, adaptation of the leadership project to your own experience. Wonderful speaker style, wonderful charisma, but make your speech more clear, more easy to follow. Thank you.
The evaluation was very structured, very professional. I like the style Irina is using for evaluation. The standard sandwich type of evaluation with a positive concrete feedback, some constructive feedback, and then conclusion. I think it was a good example for us. So now I'd like to invite to the stage Maria Kalinkina, who is personal evaluator of Vladimir Danilenko.
One more time, good evening, dear Toastmasters and guests, dear Vladimir. The second project, Secret of Life. The speech was very profound. I see that you are a risky man, Vladimir. Because it was dangerous to choose me like a personal evaluator for the speech, which begins with the pony drinking, which is also very profound. So, let me be Denis Shevchuk for a little. Evaluation form told me that you had to demonstrate it to us that you applied the feedback from your first project, from your first speech. Did you, Vladimir? So, I hope. This is the main secret of life. I thank you very much for the interesting topics that you shared with us and interesting facts. Finally, you shared with us a lot of interesting facts from that sheet. You see, guys, that Vladimir really prepared and printed for us a lot of interesting information. Honestly, I don't know how I can remember it without this sheet, but anyway, you will. You did your best. So, now I have to evaluate. Vladimir, you told us that drinks is not for fun. Why? How can we live without all of these numbers without any drinking? And also, I saw an answer in this sheet. You told us, I suggest you to go explore it for yourself. Okay, to be serious, Vladimir, relax, and you are on the right way. Yeah, because you know that public speaking presentation It's all about entertainment, how confident you are on the stage, and I guess body language. So I recommend you use it more, be more confident and relaxed. For the second, vocal variety, I guess you know about it, yeah? That, for the people who sits on the first two stages is okay, but when you sit far and far, it's pretty difficult to listen for your voice. Anyway, thank you for a great speech. You did your best and I really enjoyed it. And one day, I guess that we can cheers and drink more cognac. Keep on. Good luck.
I think for the Toastmasters to have a little drink, it's interesting connotation. In terms of your evaluation, Marina, you spent half of the time as introduction, and then when you mentioned, now I'm going to evaluate your speech, it was already 1 minute over. I think it would be good to shut down a little bit the introduction part. The other thing which I think is important for your particular speech, because it's second time you are repeating one, right? When you have to apply the recommendations from your previous evaluation, and that's exactly what you're supposed to evaluate, Maria, whether you see improvements. That's why you need to know what was the feedback originally provided to you, Vladimir. And when I hear the question, it means that you didn't know what was the feedback initially for the speech. So preparation, I think it would be good to have more on this one. Overall, I think you are pretty confident on the stage, Maria, and I think it's really really good. The next evaluator for the speech is Yermek Taktakulov, who is going to evaluate the speech of Ivan.
Dear Toastmasters, dear guests, Ivan. The purpose of your project was to learn and review basic research methods and present a well-organized, well-researched speech on any topic. And I think you reached the goal of this project. The choice of the project was very interesting, very engaging, and your speech was very, very well organized and very well researched from my point of view. At first you presented
visual example with the bag and you intrigued the audience what's in it. Then you showed the toilet paper and showed us some trick with the light, and you engaged us with asking questions about what color is it, and so you have interaction with the audience. Then you presented, you used very good presentation. You provided some history on the science, and you intertwined science and art skillfully. With the first, you said that light is a wave. Mr. Young said that light is a wave, and you provided some very visual examples of this theory of by showing us pictures of Monet. Then you said there is another theory. Einstein discovered that light is also a stream of particles. And another guy, I don't remember the name, mixed colors and used it in pictures. I wanted to listen more and more about this. I wanted to see more examples about this. I don't know how much time did you use. How long was his speech?
It was about 8 minutes.
8 minutes?
Yeah.
Really? Because I wanted to listen more and more. I thought it was short. So this is the indicator that was your speech was very engaging. And the style of your speaking was also engaging, but there are some suggestions, of course. I think you were a little bit nervous because you made the sound. I noticed this. Maybe nobody noticed that, but you did this 2 times. Maybe because of your nervousness, and you maybe moved a little bit more than enough on the stage. So try to be relaxed. Try to catch the do more eye contact with each and every person here. And what else? Maybe you can add some personal story, funny stories about the colors and how you chose this topic, so we can see the connections, your personal connection with the topic. That's all, and good luck with your other future projects. Thank you.
I also like your speech, Ivan, because it was very innovative way of presenting thing, and we had intrigued during the session. It was really good. In terms of the evaluation, Ermek, a few things. Number one, I think it would be good to pay attention to the timer, because you exceeded the limit. We have 2 minutes for evaluation. Number two, during the evaluation, it's not necessary to repeat the speech, because you tried to explain the story, and that took a little bit more time than necessary to explain how interesting the evaluation the speech was. Indeed, it was interesting. The good thing that you mentioned what was the purpose of the speech, and your overall feedback was also quite good. Thank you very much, Yermak. Now I'd like to invite to the stage Kristina Sharikina.
Dear Toastmasters, dear guests, hello.
Just one moment.
Okay. So, dear Margarita, first of all, I congratulate you on the project. Frankly speaking, for me personally, the theme of mentoring is very touching. I love being both a mentor and mentee. So firstly, in the project, you ask the audience a question about what motivates you. And then you proceed with a phrase like, my mentor is a person who inspires me. I think it's a very attractive introduction of the topic. Then you proceed with a video and with a lot of funny photos, and together with your very, I would say, attractive smiling and the light you is going outside of yours, you have warmed us up. So thank you very much from this point of view. Now let's go to the points of your project. So if we take a look at the agenda, we will see that it was an introduction to Toastmaster Mentoring, the project was called, and the purpose was to share with us some elements of your personal experience as a protégé. First of all, I would say that in any project, it's very important to follow the structure. So let's talk a bit about the structure of your project. I think that, as I have already mentioned, you have had a wonderful introduction to the topic. And then we go to the main part, to the body. And here I would offer you some recommendations. I noted that you was very emotional while you were sharing your experience. It's obvious, with such a great mentor. But still, let's see, usually in the main body you have 3 points, like 1, 2, 3. Personally for me, I haven't noted these 3 points in the main body. They were like closed behind by your own emotions. It's logic, I would feel in the same way. Basically, I would advise you to introduce these 3 points. And the first point, in the first point, you could touch on the theme of some practical advices of the relationships between mentor, thank you, and mentee. It's very interesting and important. More practical advices. In the second point, you could share with us your personal notions about the process of being a protégé. And at the third point, you can touch the results of your work and maybe in this moment show us the video. And maybe in the last video you mentioned in your presentation, because your video was overwhelmed with videos. And I felt it was like more the advertisement of Masha and her personality than your project. Generally, I congratulate you one more time on this project and keep moving on. Thank you.
Professional evaluation. Thank you. I like the style you share the feedback and the structure. Very good. You used the board, but I'm not sure why you used this pencil and 3 lines on the board. But anyway, I think the evaluation was good. the main point for you, Margarita, indeed, we had. I really like your style, of touching and emotional, speech. It was really good. But I would agree the video. Too much attention to the video we had. During the speech, and it would be good to balance it in a better way. Now it's time to have a report for our support team. And I would like to start with the report for our timer, for Karina.
So guys, today we have difficult timing, really. And I want to pay attention on the guys who don't feel the time exactly. So for our starters, counter and grammarian. Guys, your introduction was too short and there were not even have half a minute. So maybe it should be a little bit longer, 1 minute or 1.5. Then I want to tell about Maria Kalinkina. Thank you. In all cases, like a table topic speaker and like a personal evaluator, you were just on time and you were the only person among personal evaluators who were on time. Other guys exceeded their time. About table topic speakers, almost all of you were quite on time. Georgi, a little bit longer than we should have. But I think, and thank you to Nikolai who moved the break. to have Maria to have Margarita preparation, so we can manage the time.
Thank you very much for your very. Was it your first role? I think it was good. Yeah, very, very precise and factual. Very good. Now I'd like to invite to the stage Georgi for the evaluation report for a calendar.
Let's start from who said the most inappropriate words. As I count, speaker number 3, Ivan, you said more than 15, or even more. So you are probably the champion. How to say it? Like this is Christina, you said less words than nobody else. You said only one word that I heard.
What else should I say?
But overall, like on average, each person said like 7 or 8 words on each speech. So that's it.
It's good that you provided feedback for a person where improvement is required, and also for a person who had a very clean speech. It is good, but it would be good also to mention somebody else and maybe to pay attention special words which are you need for a certain person. Maybe may advise something for such person if you notice. Things which can be improved for particular for someone. So that would be for the future. It would be good to introduce into your report, and also to use time in a better way, because you have 2 minutes for introduction and 2 minutes for your report. It could be short, you know. Mm-hmm. You can be, you know, you invent something at the stage. It's not necessarily to be very how many hours and how many songs we had during the speech. But anyway, that's your first report. My congratulations. That was good. Thank you. Now I'd like to invite to the stage Marty, our grammarian.
Toastmasters. I'm the grammarian, and overall I think you speak good English, and you have, of course, a Russian accent. And some words I didn't understand, and certain can't wrote it down. And you often say things instead of things, or thank you instead of thank you. And yeah, that was the only 2 words that I written, because some words I didn't understand and couldn't write it down. But no one, it was very good. And the word of the day, profound. The first 3 speakers don't have used it, or didn't hear it. And the 4th speaker, and also then the table topics, used 3 times. And
newcomer, you are first time for our Toastmaster meetings, and you have never seen such kind of reports how people did it. But I think you managed to capture a few things, and also commenting the word of the day. I think it was good. Thank you very much, Martin, and I'm looking forward to your participation next time as well.
Thank you.
Right. That is, I think, overall for the evaluation for the meeting itself. For such kind of room. It's very big, and we are spread out within the room, and it's difficult to manage attention and eye contact with everyone with such a big room. And it's better next time when we concentrate a little bit in this part of the room instead of sitting everywhere. That's number one. Number two, I think for the speakers, we need to speak up a bit more, because people who are sitting far away from the first row, it's sometimes difficult to hear. Maybe Martin, it's one of the reasons why you didn't capture a few words in English, right? So again, it's better to be concentrated in one part of the room. I will provide feedback to Alexey Kravtsun in terms of TOS table topic exercise separately, but overall, in my view, the good thing is that it is invention. It's not traditional way of doing our table topic exercise, because normally we have 2 minutes, not 30 seconds, and the rule was a bit more complicated in my view. But Alexey tried to invent something new, which is good, and I will discuss separately with Alexey the table topic exercise as well. We started 5 minutes later, but I think overall we are already, yeah, we have 10 minutes behind of the schedule. That's why I'd like to sum up, and I think it's time already to close the meeting.